You know, tonight we're going to talk about, really, we're talking about the resurrection from the dead. And, you know, we're going to talk about the resurrection from the dead in the context of what we refer to as the catching away, which many people refer to as the rapture of the church. And, of course, there's folks that say that the rapture of the church, rapture is not in the scripture. Well, by that, by virtue of saying that, I can tell you that every word you know in English is not in the scripture. Because all that is in the scripture is Hebrew and Greek. And so we use other words to describe what we know the Hebrew and the Greek words to mean. And rapture is one of the ways that we describe a particular Greek word that just so happens to be that those who translated the authorized text would have translated catching away, and which could also be equally translated rapture, because it means the same thing. Rapture means to be caught away. So that idea is wrong for people to present that in the first place. And really what I want you to know tonight is that we're going to communicate these things not because we want you to have a doctrinal bias, because we want you to be ready. Not because we want you to have something to go argue about, be on the side of whether, you know, there's people who believe that the catching away is going to take place in the beginning, before the tribulation. Some people believe it's going to take place in the middle, right in the middle of the tribulation. And then some people believe it's going to take place in the end. And so then you have the pre-trib, the mid-trib, and the post-trib. And everybody's broken out into their individual camps. Well, I can rejoice in the fact that people are at least believing that there's going to be a catching away in the first place. Praise God for that. And somebody said, is there any reason to believe that there would be a catching away in the middle of the tribulation? Well, of course, because not everybody's an idiot. And there's people who believe that there's going to be a catching away in the middle of the tribulation. And then there's smart people that believe that, and people who love God, genuinely love God, that believe that there's going to be a catching away at the end of the tribulation. I believe everything I understand in the scripture is that there is going to be a catching away before there's ever any tribulation. And I'm going to tonight talk about why I believe that. I'm going to give a bunch of proofs. I'm not going to go into all of the arguments. I think that if I went into all of the arguments, I believe I could be more convincing with why I believe that those arguments don't really validate the different positions. But we would be here for hours and hours. And because this is a big subject, somebody asked me, and they said, so what do you think about the catching away? And I said, well, it's going to happen. And I believe the catching away is going to happen before the tribulation begins. But I can understand why there are folks who believe it's going to happen in the middle of the tribulation and at the end of the tribulation. I can understand that. I can understand where many verses of Scripture are somewhat elusive and they're not clear. They're somewhat abstract. I want you to understand that when Paul began to minister on the catching away, listen, the Lord did not give to him the revelation of Jesus Christ that was given to John. It had not been written yet. Hello. This is, you know, the Lord gave to Paul those things that he wanted Paul to minister to the church as the apostle of the Gentiles, making known the mystery of the fellowship. Did Paul have some things to say about the catching away and about the last day? Yes, he did have things to say about the catching away and about the last day that we refer to as the tribulation and the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Did he fully understand it? Well, he doesn't write in such a way to make us to know that he fully understood it. He certainly understood it in the parts that God gave to him. But I'm going to tell you someone who God did make to fully understand it, and it was John. And so what I'm going to do, and what I then encourage you to do, and I encourage the people that are listening to me by the web to do, is to let the book of Revelation be the foundation that steers you. Don't go to Matthew chapter 24 and try to get steered in what's going to happen in the end time when the Lord Jesus Christ kind of lumped everything together. However, there's a lot of things that I can concerning the last day The Lord Jesus didn't fully unveil the dimensions of when the resurrection was going to take place in context to the last day and the tribulation and the things that he referred to on the level of catastrophe that would take place in Israel as a nation. But one of the clues that you can get from Jesus is that when he began to talk about these things, he was very, very focused on Israel and the people of Israel and temple worship. And so I'm gonna give, when I refer tonight to anything that Jesus said, I'm going to give it from the 30,000 foot view, which is kind of how Jesus gave it. He gave it from a 30,000 foot view. It was just kind of an overview of it. And when I refer to the things that Paul said, I'm going to be kind of the same way. I might zero in a little bit because I think he actually got to dive down to about 5,000 feet a couple of times, like in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. But when I begin to talk about what God showed John, I'm going to get real detailed. I'm going to get more specific. I'm going to step right down in the middle of it and say, this is a detail. This is a fact. This is an event. And or if I refer to Daniel, God gave Daniel had more revelation, and through the scripture by Daniel, more revelation is given to us on end time prophecy than exist in any other place. And so we can take them by the hand and we can walk through the events with them. You know, when people try to start telling us or describing to us, you know, definite points based upon what Jesus said about the last day, wait a minute. it's kind of lumped together. It's a little bit more challenging. When people want to try to make specifics on what Paul said, hold up. You know, there is a bit of separation there, especially in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. But I'm going to be the first one to admit that Paul used, and the Greek scholars out there will understand this as well, Paul used some of the most challenging Greek language when he goes to talking about the catching away in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 than you find anywhere else in the New Testament. Why did that happen? Question mark, question mark. So I'm going to go very specific, once again, with the book of Revelation and with Daniel, and then I'm going to back out and I'm going to show you how that what Jesus said fit and how that what Paul said fit. And nobody should get mad if I should be of the faith and confidence that I don't have to go through the tribulation. Because once again, I'm not going to present this as some kind of just really flippant, loose-ended, not really confirmed information. I'm going to show you solid proofs of why I have more of a right to believe this than anyone has the right to believe in a mid-trib or a post-trib. In fact, I've tried to convince myself. I've tried to say, okay, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to approach the scripture that I'm going to be the defender of, that I've got to go through the tribulation and the catching away is going to take place, and I want to gain my information and my knowledge from the Word of God so that I can convincingly argue that point from the Word of God. I'm sorry, that's weak. It's weak. If I have to, and I would do that for you if I had more time, I would just take the position of I believe in the catching away taking place at the very end of the tribulation, and I'm going to lay out for you my facts and my proofs from the scripture tonight. I could do that and take that position. And then I could go ahead and take the position, okay, now I'm a different guy, forget that guy. I'm going to take the position that I believe that there's the catching away is going to take place in the middle of the tribulation, and I would lay out facts, and I could actually give you more facts for the middle tribulation, for going up in the middle, than I can for the end, okay? And then I'm going to say, forget that guy. Once I'm done with that, because I can't give you a whole lot, I can give you more than I can for the post, I'm going to say, now I'm this new guy over here, and I'm going to lay out the presentation of the facts for why I believe that the catching away will take place before the tribulation. And guess what? At the end of the analysis, I am going to be able to present you in an unbiased way. I am, by volume of information and data and scriptures, I am going to be able to present a more convincing argument concerning being caught away before the tribulation begins than in either other position. So you cannot fault me. You can't fault me. You can just disagree with me, but you can't say, ah, he's an idiot. He believes in the catching away before the tribulation. And so, and then, you know, I hear these anecdotal statements made like, oh, well, no one taught about the catching away until the 1800s. No, that's just really not true. Or like I said, you know, the rapture is proof that these guys don't know what they're talking about because rapture is not found in the Bible. Once again, by the same argument, none of the rest of the English words are found there either, or Latin words or other derivative words that we use in the English language that are derivatives of Latin or Greek, okay, place of origin, whatever. It's Hebrew or it's Greek. So this, having said that, I want to open up tonight with a couple of statements that Paul made. And well, just first of all, I want to open up with this statement in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. No, I don't. I'm not going to do that. I'll go to that here in just a minute. I would rather open up with, Father, I just ask you to heal these people with respiratory problems here tonight, in Jesus' name. That their lungs will work like you purpose for them to work, and that sickness and disease won't be harassing them anymore the rest of their life. In Jesus' name, amen. Everybody in here, if you've got pain, problems, torments, worries, you're stressed out, whatever, concerned, fearful, you just feel good now. In Jesus' name, feel good. So you can sit here and feel good the whole time. Amen. I'm gonna back away a little bit. I wanna back away and look at just an overview to start with from the book of Daniel. So I want you to turn with me to Daniel chapter 9 before I get into too many detailed specifics. Let's just kind of look at a general picture of things. Daniel chapter 9, and let's look down at verse 24. Now, the Lord said to Daniel, 70 weeks are determined upon the people, upon your people, Israel, and upon the holy city, Jerusalem, to finish the transgressions, to make an end of sins, to make a reconciliation for iniquity, praise God, to bring in everlasting righteousness, hallelujah, and to seal up the vision and prophecy and to anoint the most holy. So the Essenes, a group of Jewish folks back in the time of Jesus, were able to take that information that was given in the book of Daniel, and they were able to calculate to the very day that the Messiah, Christ Jesus, was crucified or cut off. Now, they didn't know that it was going to go down like that. They thought that that was actually referring to this great battle that was going to take place in the heavens against the sons of light against the sun, and the sons of darkness, and they were preparing to be a part of that. The point that I want to make is that you can number on these total, this dispensation, this framework of time, the very days and number of days concerning the events that are described in the book of Daniel off of these 70 weeks. 70 weeks that ultimately found its 69th week concluded by the crucifixion of the Lord Jesus Christ on Passover in approximately AD 30, almost 2,000 years ago. Okay. With this, and what's very important to recognize is that these 70 weeks, therefore, are a reliable time frame so that we can predict what's going to happen when God is specifically focused on dealing with His people, Israel, and the holy city, Jerusalem. Now, we've had a time period between the 69th week and the 70th week that has lasted almost 2,000 years, about 15 years short of 2,000 years. there's got to be a big question, why? What was going on in the 69 weeks before? It was God specifically dealing with Israel as a nation. It was confined to the holy people of God within the first covenant, centered around Jerusalem and temple worship. Well, when we go and we look at Jesus describing this, he's going to begin to talk about end time prophecy utilizing the book of Daniel. And he's going to highlight as a time point, as a key time point, he is going to highlight the abomination that will make the temple desolate. Now, there's a lot of things to say about that. You could go back to Antiochus Epiphanes, which is a great type of the Antichrist, did many things that the Antichrist is going to do, but came short of everything that the Antichrist will do. We could talk about Caligula, Caesar, who also in I seem to recall right around about 66 AD, also desecrated the temple. It was sometime right around in there, after the death of Jesus. And maybe it wasn't out that far. I think Titus was reigning by then, perhaps. I just haven't reviewed that for a while. But those of you who know ancient history, you know that I'm very, very close here. But Caligula, he set up an image of himself in the Holies of Holies, okay? And then, of course, by 70 AD, the temple was completely destroyed. And there's all kinds of various different things you can read about those events that took place there. And then, of course, then another great event took place, and one final event that just basically decimated everything, and then 134 to 136 AD. So it was like the last diaspora, if you would, the last great event that just wiped everything out, cleaned everything off the map almost, and anybody that was left pretty much was also sent to the uttermost parts of the earth. Somebody said, well, why are you talking about this? Why are you going into this detail? Because the 70th week begins at the very first day of the tribulation. It's not about the church anymore. It's right now, it's not about the 70th week. When the 70th week begins, it's not about the church anymore. It's about Israel. It's all about Israel. It's all about the people of Daniel. It's once again, the clock takes place, starts ticking. I'm going to tell you, we know that there is a coming of the Lord that no man knows the day or the hour. Listen to me. I know if I were going to go through the entire tribulation and I came to the moment of the abomination that makes the temple desolate, I could tell you the very day that the Lord will come. That coming, I could tell you the very day, because just like the Essenes were able to calculate the very day, just like Jesus said, the rocks will cry out unless they start saying, if they would stop saying, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. The rocks, it's the appointed time, it's the very day. The calendar is fixed. God showed us certain details that are very convincing about the fixed calendar. So if I'm going through the tribulation and I come to the abomination that makes the temple desolate, I can tell you the number of days which Christ Jesus will come down out of heaven to fight against the armies of the Antichrist, the day he come out of heaven with his mighty host of the redeemed. So that's one of my very strong arguments. Number one, I'm not going to go into those arguments tonight, all the various different arguments that I have that people are going to have to deal with, that they're going to believe that the catching away comes at the end of the tribulation. But that's a very important one. Now, you may argue that you couldn't count the number of days to the abomination that makes the temple desolate, because you would have to have a specific event that takes place on the calendar so that you know that the 70th week begins. And I believe I have a clue and an event that would allow me to number the days from the moment in time that the 70th week begins. I'm not going to go in that tonight. I'm going to leave that for another night. But I'm trying to emphasize that this is no small matter when we begin to talk about the 70 weeks that are determined upon Israel and the holy city. That this is the major point. It's God's focused dealing with Israel as a nation. I'm going to tell you that the Bible shows to us that the time of the Gentiles is fulfilled. It's done. It's over. In Romans chapter 11, there is actually clues and indication that the time of the Gentiles being fulfilled is the time of the resurrection of the just, and the time at the resurrection of the just is the time that Israel is brought back in. So this is pretty radical stuff, isn't it? Are you staying focused with me here? The time of the Gentiles is fulfilled, as is said in Romans 11:25. And listen, I'm going to tell you something. People say, well, there's going to be a great move of God during the tribulation. There's going to be the manifested sons. There is no picture of manifested sons unless you're going to make the angel flying through the heavens with the everlasting gospel a picture of the manifested sons, and you're not allowed to do that. Because now you're taking away from the book of Revelation, and I'm not going to take away because I don't want my name taken out of the book of life. And so I'm going to do my very best. I'm going to watch after my own soul to start with. I want to make heaven, and I'm not going to take away from it, and neither am I going to add to it, because he said, if you want to go through the tribulation, basically, Mary, let me paraphrase, just go ahead and add to this book. So I don't want to go. If you add to this book, then the consequences of adding to this book is that these plagues of this book is going to be added to you. You're going to go through the tribulation. So that right there is another clue that I'm not going through it if I don't add to it. Are you with me? Okay, so I'm just trying to get just a basic groundwork, a framework of reference laid out here. Listen, there's no awakening going on in the tribulation. The times of the Gentiles are over. The door is shut. People aren't hungry for God. Look, here is what we see. We see men who know that what they're going through is God's wrath being poured out upon them because of sin and iniquity. The tribulation, when it comes to the Gentiles, is not evangelizing. It's God pouring out his wrath and his judgment upon their wickedness and their ungodliness, because just like the time of the Amorites had fully come and God levied judgment against the Amorites, the time of the Gentiles has fully come. The day is now of accountability is here. It is the day of judgment and wrath. There is no place in the scripture that even hints that the time of the tribulation is a period of time of grace. It doesn't exist. It's just the opposite. It is a time of God's wrath and judgment. Now let's look at the effect. Men on the earth know that it is God's wrath and judgment being poured out from upon them. And rather than repent, they saying, let the rocks fall on us, crush us, hide us from the face of the one who sits upon the throne and the Lamb. We want nothing to do with him. You talk about rebellion. It is the day and period. Listen to me, people. It is the day and the period of the apostasy, which means the great rebellion against God, not the great awakening, not the great coming back to the Lord. So I've got to say to the people that are in the church, what are you doing in the tribulation? What is it fundamentally that you're going to be doing? It isn't about the church. It is about Israel. Are you going to be evangelizing Israel? What is the question? You tell me, you show me any proofs that show or demonstrate that any Gentile is given, becomes a part of the first resurrection during the tribulation. Now you have to parse some couple of things out here. Remember, there are many people that live throughout the world that are not going to be destroyed in the great devastation of that 7 years of tribulation, that are going to go into the millennial reign of Christ as living human beings, not part of the first resurrection. The only clue that we have of anybody becoming a part of the first resurrection during the days of the tribulation, listen to this very carefully, is that they are beheaded or martyred for the name of Jesus. That's it. And that is very clearly focused upon the nation of Israel, because the only person that's really doing any evangelizing is the Antichrist, and he's doing the opposite kind of evangelizing. He's winning the armies for Satan. And that's what, you listen, if the crown jewel of the scripture is the resurrection from the dead. And are you going to tell me that the resurrection of the dead takes place during the time of the 7-year tribulation or the 70th week of Daniel's vision concerning Israel and the holy city, and that it's not going to be featured in the book of Revelation? Well, that's just too hard for me to accept. This is the crowning event of all that God has done to redeem man, the resurrection of the righteous, the resurrection of the just, and there is no place in the tribulation, during the 7-year tribulation, for that to take place. No place. And then that would be the strongest argument for the post-trib people to say, look, it's just not there. It's got to be at the very end, because you see, they're pictured in heaven in chapter 19 at the marriage supper of the Lamb. And I say, wait a minute, hold up. The marriage supper of the Lamb's already been going on. You're not going to tell me that the Lord is going to do this thing as it were in a day. Come on. The reality of it is the saints, the resurrected saints, appear in heaven at the very beginning in Revelation chapter 4 and Revelation chapter 5. Okay? So this foundation is critical. I mean, it's absolutely essential. Just knowing that the tribulation is about God's wrath and judgment being poured out upon iniquity. It's about God dealing primarily with rebellious and wicked men that are apostate, that have no ability to be redeemed. There is no indication of any Gentile being redeemed. There's just the opposite. All of the nations set themselves against God in the holy city. Are you with me? Another very important point is that now all the terminology in during the time of the tribulation, beginning in chapter 4, and well, in the emphasis beginning in Revelation chapter 6, is not about the church. It's about temple worship. Jesus made it about temple worship. Temple worship don't even exist right now. There have been a number of different men and groups that have tried to rebuild the temple over the past 2,000 years, and every one of them, and it wasn't because they were short of finances, and it wasn't because they were short of influence and armies. God says no. He wouldn't allow it. One great event by the Catholic Church in the 5th century, God wouldn't allow it. I believe Titus was the general. Titus was one of the generals that besieged my history. I recall my history correctly. Titus was one of the generals that besieged Jerusalem. I believe that Rome in 70 AD besieged Jerusalem with five different armies. And they were just tearing it apart. There was Josephus describes it as having great trees and being beautiful. They ravaged the land and left it desolate and empty because they took all the trees and all the wood and made their ramparts and all their other defenses. Just decimated the thing. Took it from beauty to total decimation. And then, of course, Titus then became Caesar. And they erected temples to various different gods. I'm trying to remember. I believe they actually erected the temple of Jupiter. I believe that's what Titus did. Erected the temple of Jupiter. Is that right? Erected the temple of Jupiter on the Temple Mount. So that now you're trying to find the Temple Mount. And where is the foundation? Well, some people want to believe that it's where the Dome of the of the mosque is right now, but you know, the verdict's still out. The point of it is, when the 70th week starts, its focus is on the rebuilding of the temple, the holy city. It's on Jerusalem, the holy city. This is for people to come along and say, well, no, this is symbolic terminology. You have no right to say that, because it is what it is. There is going to be, spoken by the prophet Daniel, by the Lord Jesus Christ, and also in the book of Revelation, an event where the temple is going to be desolated. And it's not in the time, my goodness, it's not in the time of Antiochus Epiphanes, because Jesus talked about a future day. He's after Antiochus. Get your calendar correct. Hello. And nothing like this happened with Caligula, or especially with Titus. Nothing like this happened. They just destroyed, burned the whole thing down. Okay? Jesus is talking about a future event where there's going to be temple worship. There's going to be the evening and the morning sacrifice. And somehow the holies of holies is going to be made desolate. And hello, it can't be made desolate unless first it's occupied. So it's very clear that God is bringing his glory back into the midst of the holies of holies. And some people say, I don't understand that. Well, you're going to have to discuss it with the Father. People tell me, I don't understand how there can be a millennial temple as described in Ezekiel, and there's constant sacrifices going on, just like in the Old Testament. I can tell you, I know why. God showed me why. I understand it. Before it was a testimony of the coming of the Lord Jesus, then it's going to be a testimony that he came and what he did. It's going to be a constant living declaration and testimony of our redemption at Calvary, just like it was a constant living testimony of the redemption that would come. Hallelujah. And every ball, the people are going to get to see it. It's going to be relived for them. It's going to be a sermon continually preached. And there's more things to say about that, but you know me, I get all sidetracked and distracted. I won't be talking about the important points that are at hand. The focus is on Israel and the holy city. That's what Daniel made the 70th week about. You cannot separate Daniel's 70th week from the 7-year tribulation. They are one and the same. It is about Israel. It's God's final dealings with them. And then when we look over in Romans chapter 11, let's go over there real quickly. I got to try to keep this short. I'm going to try to keep this to an hour. It's going to be a very difficult and challenging thing for me to do. But I'm going to just try to do my very best to just hit some of the highlights here and go to Romans chapter 11. And I just want you to look. Somebody said, can't you just kind of like write it all out there and give me just very clear, detailed points? No, the Lord kind of left it a little bit obscure. And you got to go with the information that is given and stick with the information that is given. But I want you to see this before I take you over to Revelation chapter 1 and show you an important point that convinces me that the catching of the way is before the tribulation. And Romans chapter 12 verse 15 says, for if the casting away of them be the reconciling of the world, when did that happen? On the 69th week. Hello. I just want to make sure everybody's hearing me. I'll make sure that nothing else is distracting you and running interference here and on the web. I want you to understand. I want you to get this. It isn't that difficult. Somebody said it's so challenging for me to talk about this last day's information. Evangelist Tim Hall said that to me one day. Tim is a champion now because he went to studying. He went to applying himself. And now he is a champion that the catching of the way is truly before the tribulation because he just applied himself. I said, man, just remove yourself from all the philosophy about it. Get into the Word. Go with the Word of God. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, you ain't going to do that in a month. You're going to put years into it because there's a lot of information here, okay? There's a lot of things to get sorted out. You know, you got to declare the Word in context. You can't extract information and just put it wherever you want to place it, okay? So, the Lord says, if the casting away of them be the reconciling of the world, does everybody understand why I say that's the 69th week? Because the reconciling of the world took place when? When Jesus was crucified. Daniel said that the 69th week concluded when the Messiah was cut off. You get that? Do you want me to go through that again? Good thing it's on tape. You can review it as many times as you need till you get it. Because there's certain points that need to be in your spirit so you know how to navigate. There's pegs in the ground. If you don't have pegs in the ground, you don't have a chronology. You don't know where to put anything. You don't know how to get from point A to point B. Okay? Are you with me? Okay, so then what shall the receiving of them be back in? What shall the receiving of them back in be but the resurrection, life from the dead? See that? See that? Life from the dead. See that? You see that? I'm telling you right now, it can be nothing. The receiving of them back in has to be the 70th week being initiated, the veil taken off of them, temple worship reinstituted that brings them to Jesus, 144,000 being separated, an unveiling to God. And what does it produce? The resurrection, life from the dead. Hello, not at the middle, not at the end. Do you see that? I haven't even got to my strong points yet. Just hang on. I'm just laying a basic foundation. I'm holding my big points for last. Amen. Amen. I'm just trying to express to you, I'm not pointing the finger. I'm not saying bad guy. I'm not saying dummy. How can you believe that? I'm just simply saying, I'm just want to convince you, this is why. Listen, I'm not trying. I'm before the Lord. And even tonight, I submit everything to the Lord, even before I begin this meeting. Lord, if there's anything that I believe that's not of you, I want you to correct me. I want you to stop my mouth. I want to be reproved. I want it your way. I'm not interested in trying to basically, you know, prove how smart I am or how right I am. I'm hungry. I'm just hungry. Prove to me that I'm going to go through the tribulation. And tell me why I got to go through it when I'm the redeemed of the Lord. And I've been saved by grace. And Jesus bore my wrath. And if you tell me that it's because I got to get purified, then I'm going to say, then Grandpa's got to be raised up. And great-grandpa, and great-great-great-grandpa, and great-great-great-great-great-preacher grandpa, he got to get raised up. So he can get purified too. I've been purified by the blood of the Lamb. And that don't make any sense. I'm sorry, that doesn't make any sense. I'm not trying to be, you know, mean or disrespectful. I'm just saying it just doesn't make any sense. I've got to think about that again. Hello. And so, you know, verse 25 is very pointed. For I would not have you to be ignorant. When Paul says that, he when he pulls out the ignorant word, come on, guys, don't be ignorant concerning the mystery. Don't be stupid anymore. You don't have to be blinded. It's not going to be a mystery to you anymore. You get to see it. It's not going to be something that you don't know anymore. This is something you get to know. I'm not going to have you to be ignorant concerning the mystery, that you should be wise in your own conceit, that blindness in part is happening to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles come in. And I'm going to tell you, the 70th week is about God opening up the eyes of Israel that they are no longer blind. It happens at the beginning of the tribulation. And it's seen with 144,000. And it's all about God dealing with Israel. It's all about God bringing them back. Somebody said, well, the church isn't mentioned in the book of Revelation, but saints are. Yeah, but you know what? Saints are God's people in both covenants. Somebody says, are you still trying to say that there's going to be yet a third covenant? No, I'm just saying God's turning back to focus on the nation of Israel. It's their 70th week. It's his last week of dealings, just like he dealt with them exclusively for 69 weeks. He's going to deal with them exclusively for the 70th week to ultimately give them every opportunity to take their place to rule with him and reign with him, to rule with a rod of iron, in fact. Okay? So, he says then, I don't want you to be ignorant of the mystery, lest you should be wise in your own conceit. Blindness in part is happening in Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles comes in. Fullness of the Gentiles is when it's over. It's done. It's like the time or the fullness of the Amorites has not yet come. That's what God was telling Abraham. Look, the time of the Amorites has not fully come. The fullness of the Amorites has not yet come. In other words, I'm still dealing with them. Now, once it's done, then what did God do? He said, go in and wipe them out. Man, woman, boy, child, baby, everything. They're past help. They've apostated. their past help, destroy them utterly. He gave them a space and a time. When the fullness of the Gentiles come in, this idea, this doctrine, that somehow the gospel is going to be being preached to the nation during the tribulation, simply, where are the verses of Scripture that even suggest that? And then once you've got the verses of Scripture to suggest that, then tell me, how does that in any way line up with the fact that the fullness of the Gentiles has already fully come? It's done. It's over. It's finished. And then tell me, how is it that you're having this great signs and wonders and miracles and you're reaching all these people, but yet over and again in the book of Revelation, God's dealing with man, and he says, like, he's checking in with man, and he keeps saying, almost like a course, and still they will not repent. So when you've got God saying, and he's dealing with the nations of the earth in his judgment and his direct dealing with them, where they know it's the hand of God and judgment upon them, he's saying that they will not repent. There is no revival context there, not for the nations. It is, however, for Israel. There is revival for the nation of Israel. Hallelujah. Focused on the 144,000 to begin with, 12,000 virtuous Jews who have not known women. They're men who've not known women. I mean, they're virtuous Jews. I mean, this is the chapter, Revelation chapter 14 is not symbolic. It's literal. It's as literal as Revelation chapter 7 that talks about it. It's Revelation chapter 12 that refers to the woman Israel and the man child that she brings forth, or the baby boy that she brings forth that is immediately caught up to heaven. It's not Jesus. It's not the church. The context of it is, and the application is, the 144,000 that go and rule the nations with a rod of iron because they have a special place with the Lord Jesus Christ as resurrected saints that nobody else has. There is a catching away, no doubt. There is a catching away in the middle of the tribulation, but there is no indication that that is the church. The focus is Israel. It's the revival of Israel. It's the 70th week of God dealing with the nation of Israel and dealing with the holy city, Jerusalem. And so there's temple worship there. Again, God's glory is there, because if God's glory is not there, then what Daniel said and Jesus says has no meaning, because we already understand that what would constitute temple worship honored by God, and it is his glorious presence in the holies of holies. And there's no way, once again, for the holies of holies to be made desolate unless it's occupied. It is meaningless. I can't ultimately agree with a doctrinal idea that makes the scripture meaningless or allegorical without any basis of the literal, that is not defined by our own ideas and private interpretation. It's got to be defined by the Word of God, because there's no scripture that is given to be defined by any personal private interpretation. The Word of God reveals itself, and it's got to be the unveiling. And Paul said, I don't want you to be ignorant of the mystery. There's no more of a mystery here. You know what? The book of Revelation is the book of unveiling, the book of revealing, not the book of hiding. And it's not the book of mystery. Nobody can. It's not the book of you cannot understand. It's not the book of it's still a secret. It's not a book of we'll let you know later. It's the book of here's the answer. Here's the unveiling. Now you get to understand everything. Paul said everything. Jesus said everything. Daniel said everything. Ezekiel said, Isaiah, etc. There's a lot to learn here. See, there's actually more issues that come to bear. I'm not even going to hit on them. I'm doing a book right now, The Rise of the Seventh to the Eighth Kingdom. And one of the last chapters is a complete collapse of society. And, that whole dimension of the complete collapse of society, really, and that's provable from Scripture. Of course, I'm laying out the Scripture that proves the complete society, the turning back of the clock to where there's just, you know, somebody said, how can that be? Well, listen, shut down the oil, shut down the refineries, and the machine will come to a stop and rust. Well, we're working on hydrogen fuel. Well, I tell you right now, I just hope that works out for you. Because right now you need to have a tank about as big as this room to get you across the state. Well, we'll get you up to Bakersfield anyways. It's not quite that bad. I guess a hydrogen tank running a little VW could get you over there to, it could probably get you to Stockton, right there by Sacramento. So we got all these great plans, but those plans haven't bear more fruition. There's some dynamics there. There's some laws of the universe that Father chooses whether or not he's going to let us know about them. Okay. I'm just going to leave that there. I want you to go to Revelation with me. Revelation chapter 1, verse 19. You cannot ignore the evidence. If you don't agree with my evidence, then you're going to have to give me a convincing explanation of what it means instead. Okay? Revelation chapter 1, verse 19 is one of those. So Jesus appears, gives his revelation, the unveiling, the revealing, the making known of the mystery to John. And he says, okay, here's what I want you to do, John. I want you, verse 19, write the things which you've seen, write the things which are, and write the things which shall be hereafter. So let's just take it one by one. He wrote the things that he saw, chapter 1, he saw Jesus standing in the midst of the golden candlesticks, 7 stars in his right hand, you know, eyes flame of fire, hair like white as wool, right? Feet like they on brass on fire in an oven. I'm in a furnace, right? Then he said he wrote the things which are. What was it? What did he write next then? He wrote an address to the 7 churches. So I know what is, write the things which are there. We all know what he saw, and we all know what came after with the things which are. Okay? Are means the things that are happening right now where you're at, right there at that moment in time. And it also means those things that you are responsible for, which would then include the entire church age, because he's talking to us right here tonight in the church age. So we still in the R because we still in the churches. And you got church, 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 church. Spirit says to the church. Spirit says to the church. Spirit says to the church. Church. Spirit says to the church. Spirit says to the church. Church. And then it stops. And he says, write the things which are hereafter. Now, if you're reading this in the Greek language, you're going to read here and write the things meta tauto. And you're not going to see that word. You're not going to see that exist. You're not going to even see the things which are hereafter until all of a sudden you're reading along. You get finished. You got read to the church. And then all of a sudden you heard the last thing about the church. And where do you hear the last thing about the church? Revelation 3:22. It's the last word. The last word is church. Revelation 3:22. Look at it. See this? The things are, see, look, Revelation chapter 3:22, last thing is church. What's the next thing? Meta tautu. You're not going to hear about the church ever again. Now, that's just too big of a voice. That's too loud of a statement. Hello. And then guess what? This is the only time you hear a trumpet and somebody getting caught up. Now, is that just coincidental? Well, if you believe that's coincidental, you're going to have to stop for a minute and just rethink yourself. And wait a minute. You can't throw away the information that is given and speculate on the information that isn't given. That doesn't make any sense at all. Let's deal very, very clearly with the information. I almost said very queerly. Let's deal very clearly, because I'm afraid it is too queerly. Odd. Are we doing it in an odd, weird, strange fashion? Let's deal very clearly with the evidence that we have and understand them with respect to what's being said and in its context. And so we hear in chapter 4, we hear meta tauto, write the things which are the church, write the things which shall be hereafter. Meta tauto. After this, I looked, and behold, a door was open in heaven. It's time to go to heaven. John's representative of the church. He's got the revelation. He's going to heaven. Door's open. Now we can go. Why would you override that piece of information? That, for me, is a giant looming clue. If I was on a hunt for treasure and I got that as a clue, I'm going to go, whoa, that is a clue. Hold up a second. Because now we got meta tauto, voice, door open in heaven, voices a trumpet saying, come on up. And then the next thing we see in chapter 4 and chapter 5 is we see the company of saints. We see the 24 elders dressed in fine white linen and resurrected suits. Hallelujah. And their resurrection, their resurrected, in their resurrected bodies sitting around the throne. Well, then the resurrection's happened.
Right.
Oh, no. Can't be. Because I believe in the tribulation in the middle. Well, hold up. Hold up. Because wait a minute. When you get to chapter 7, you see already in heaven before. That works. We can wrap. We can make a wrap with that. So you get to chapter 7, you see already in heaven. Amen. The great company of saints. And this is at the very beginning of the tribulation. Let me get this for you here. What is it? Is it verse 10 or verse 11? Verse 9. Chapter 7. After this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude which no man could number, of all nations, of all kindred, of all people, of all tongue, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hand. They gained the victory. They already there at the beginning. Well, it's already showed the company of saints represented by the 24 elders in chapter 4 and chapter 5. Now, at the very beginning of tribulation, we already see the great company of saints. This isn't the tribulation saints. Yeah, it says they come out of great tribulation, but it's in the context that from Abel we've come out of great tribulation. Tell the martyrs over the years that they didn't go through great tribulation. They got trampled by elephants and torn in two by lions at first. Before they themselves were torn in two by lions, they had to watch their babies get torn, their little children get torn in two by lions and stomped by a beast and devoured by all kinds of wild animals. After having been living in a dark dungeon for about 4 years. Hello. And besides that, the tribulation saints, those who are martyred for the Lord, those who are beheaded, they're not allowed. It's already been proven in chapter 6 that they have to stay under the altar until all the saints, all the tribulation saints, all of those who are martyred during the tribulation are fulfilled and complete. And that's not until the end of the tribulation. So it's already laid out. God said, you're not going to be seen. You're going to be hidden away until the time that till the very last tribulation saint is martyred. You see that? He lets us know right off the bat that you're not going to see the company of the martyred saints standing before the throne. Somebody wants to make chapter 7, verse 9, the company of tribulation saints. That just doesn't fit. That doesn't work. Now, you know, how much time have I run into here already? So I'm already at an hour. Let me just try to get some of the main highlights here for you. And, you know, I shouldn't leave Revelation here and go back and Let me just go back right now. We'll just come back to Revelation. Let me go and look at the promises. Let me go look at a couple of the promises that everybody's familiar with that Paul made. And let's just start in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. As I had suggested, we would start at the very beginning. I think we're there now. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Paul says, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of an archangel, with the trump of God, and dead in Christ shall rise first. So, when does that happen in the tribulation? When does that happen in the book of Revelation? It doesn't happen. Was Paul wrong? No, Paul was right. It simply does not happen anywhere in the context of the 70th week, the tribulation, or the metatauta. It doesn't happen. It has to happen before then. because you're already going to see the saints in heaven by many proofs. The 24 elders that are featured there in Revelation 4 and Revelation 5. The great innumerable company of saints dressed in white in their resurrection uniforms. Amen. Their resurrected suits. Hallelujah. With palm branches in hand. They gained the victory. You're not. That's the point of having been part of the first resurrection. It's done. It's over. You're finished. You're good. You're there. Amen. Hallelujah. It's done. Hallelujah. It's done. And we didn't even get this thing started yet as far as the 70th week. And they're already in heaven. They're already around the throne. Praise God. It's just something that was revealed at the time because he opened up the seal and said, let me show you what else is going on up here. And say they were caught up. It's just they're already there. They're already there. Important. Then, when you get to Revelation chapter 19, they're already there. Blessed and holy is he who's called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. We know when the marriage supper of the Lamb is going to take place. Marriage supper of the Lamb takes place during the period of time of the tribulation, the 7-year tribulation. That's what's going on in heaven. Somebody says, well, you know, we're getting basically at the end, at the very end, which I could tell you that if it were the end, I could tell you the very day. And basically the day and hour of the coming of the Lord Jesus, which we know we can't do, so that ain't going to work. Well, let's just say we did. And then we get caught up. We're going to stand before the judgment seat of the Lord. Every one of us is going to give an account for the deeds done in our body. We're going to see the rewards according to deeds done in our body. We're going to have the marriage supper of Lamb. We're going to get on our horses, and we come back with the Lord Jesus, and it's basically a day. That's ridiculous. I mean, nothing's impossible with God, but come on, look. You know, I'm very familiar with years becoming like a moment. I'm not familiar with a moment becoming like years. That's what happens when it's not going good. Like you're sitting on a hot stove for a second. It's like, oh, I was there for a year. I mean, it hurts. You know every moment of that second. You never know every nanosecond of that second. You can count them. At least one of them are slowed down. No. That doesn't make any sense. How does that make any sense? Because you look here in Revelation chapter 19, I know I told you to turn to 1 Thessalonians, but I just want to make sure everybody sees everybody in heaven. See, somebody said, he acts like he doesn't know what he's going to say next. Perceptive. I don't. Huh? I'm just ready for the Lord to speak right through my mouth and tell me whatever. To say whatever. Hallelujah. Bring it, Holy Ghost. You here to lead us and guide us in all truth? We ask him for a piece of bread, you're not going to give us a stone. Say, chew on that. Amen. Hallelujah. We already went through that. That was Wednesday night. Wednesday night was awesome. I was so blessed on Wednesday night. I went home so drunk in the Holy Ghost, hard to get to sleep. But you look in Revelation chapter 19 real quickly, and you can see, just start there in verse 7. Let us be glad. This is before the Lord returns, okay? Sometime before he returns, okay? This is like a big, gigantic parenthetical statement. This is before the Battle of Armageddon, the big war at the end of the tribulation. He says, let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife hath made herself ready. Praise God. That's us. That's the church. Church is a part of that. Actually, to just limit the church, limit the wife or bride of the Lord Jesus Christ to being the church is not altogether accurate. Because we got to include Abraham and Moses and Abel and everybody else. That everybody, all saints are part of the bride of Christ, which is a wonderful thing. But she's made herself ready for the marriage. Give honor. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and the wife has made herself ready. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white. For the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. Where did I see them at? I saw them over there at the beginning. Where'd you see them? When I was reading the book of Revelation, I saw them in chapter 7. They were already up there before things ever even got underway. The seals haven't even all been broken yet. Huh? And somebody said, well, they got caught away. They got it caught away under the sixth seal. Well, that would be unique. That's another. We're going to add that one to the whole list. So now we got pre and then beginning and to add to mid and post. No, that wouldn't be proper. Okay, hopefully that makes sense. So, and he said unto me, right blessed are they which are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. I'm going to be called. Marriage supper of the Lamb is absolutely indistinguishable between the resurrection of the righteous dead, the saints that are brought in. Now, somebody says, the 144,000 a part of that. They are a part of that. There's no question about that. Are the tribulation saints part of that? Yes, to some degree, they're going to be part of that, I think. I believe. It's like coming in late for communion, though. And you know, I'm saying that kind of humorously. When I fell at his feet to worship him, or rather, blessed are they that which are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said unto these to me, these are the true sayings of God. Okay, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. All I wanted to do is I'm making a point. Do you see? Where do you see the saints? In heaven. Marriage supper is going on in heaven. Judgment seat of Christ. Where is it going on? It's got to be going on in heaven. It's not going on during the. It's not going on in earth in the tribulation. You're not just seeing those things happening, you know, so to speak, after the tribulation. You're seeing them happening during the tribulation when it comes to what's taking place in heaven while the tribulation is going on in earth. Is there a heaven going on in heaven while there's hell going on in earth? Yeah, there is. What is the tribulation about? Two things. It's about the bringing in of Israel, the 70th week, God's final week of dealing with Israel to bring them in to their place and position in the covenant. And it's about God's wrath being poured out upon all sin and iniquity. Who is the only group of people that are preserved from the wrath and kept from the wrath of God? The 144,000, they're the only ones sealed. You cannot make yourself one of the 144,000. You just can't do it. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, for the Lord himself, here we go. Verse 15, here's what Paul says. Let's start at 15. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep or them which are dead. Now, notice the we. He didn't say you guys out there in the future. Paul had himself included in this. Paul really believed that he was going to be a part of the catching away. Every time he talks about it, he includes himself in it. He's not talking about going through the tribulation. Guys, there's going to be a great revival, great outpouring of God, the Holy Ghost. We're going to go through the tribulation. All these plagues and things are going to be happening right, left, and center. But we're going to be completely, you know, immune from it. And they're going to be able to touch us. 1,000 will fall by our side, 10,000 by our right hand. That's not the case. That's not true in the tribulation. In the tribulation, no longer does the church, no longer can we say that Satan can't prevail against the church. No longer can we say that we cast out devils. No longer can we say that we tread upon scorpions and serpents over all power of the enemy and nothing can by any means hurt us. That church authority doesn't exist in the tribulation because the scripture says that Satan is given power over the saints, not the church, the saints, because we're talking about God's dealing with his people, Israel. The saints, those of Israel who turn their life over to the Lord, who will not take the mark of the beast, who just like Daniel and his three companions, Meshach, Meshach, and Abednego, would not bow to the image. They won't bow either. They're men and women that have been transformed with the power of God. Hallelujah. It's true. And they won't take the image or the mark, and they're killed for that sake. And it's happening right in their territory, and it's right in the central. They're the central, as it were, focus of all that's going on in modern-day Iraq. Now, I'll tell you right now, concerning the nations, Will that mark of the beast be imposed upon the nations? Sure. Would that Luciferian cult be imposed upon the nations? Sure. And everyone that takes a mark is going to be cast into the lake of fire. Huh? And then about people getting saved and being sealed by the Holy Ghost, it's about people being damned and sealed by Satan. Now those who don't receive the mark and those who remain alive, that go through all the tribulation and that fraction of the humanity that remains alive, then they go into the millennial reign as natural human beings. They're never going to be a part of the first resurrection. You got to sort that out. They will never be a part of the first resurrection. The first resurrection ends. It's ended. And as far as we know, it's ended with the two witnesses at the very, almost at the very end of the tribulation, not completely at the end of the tribulation. It's like the two witnesses are holding off the armies of the Antichrist and the things that Satan himself would try to do, destroy the people of Israel until Jesus comes with his saints. The Lord will come with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment upon all the ungodly, which the ungodly did save ungodly committed. Enoch prophesied that before the days of Noah's flood. And it's recorded by Jude. And we see all of that being set up in Revelation chapter 19. So here we are. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead of Christ shall rise first. And so people would say, well, this is the trump of God. That's then talking about the man-child being caught up. Hold up. You're really then mixing a whole lot of things together that will not blend. First and foremost, it's already been laid out that there is the woman, a sun-clothed woman, that with the 12 stars, that has already been interpreted by Jacob. That's Joseph's dream. That's speaking of Israel. That's speaking of Rachel, Jacob, and the 12 sons. Jacob already gave that interpretation to Joseph. So when you're looking at a sun-clothed woman, you're not looking at the church. You're looking at Israel. You're not looking at the Holy Ghost. You're looking at Israel. Very clearly Israel. Once again, by Jacob's own interpretation of that dream that used exactly the same symbolism. And she brings forth the man-child, and the way that it is connected together with Revelation chapter 14, it's unmistakable to be proof of the 144,000. So somebody says, no, the man-child is the church. Or the baby boy, it's better to say it that way. The baby boy is the church. The baby boy is the church. Okay, well, let's say the baby boy is the church. Well, then where then did Jesus come with a shout of an archangel, descend from heaven with a shout of an archangel and the trump of God? Because there is no trump of God there. Trumps are over. Trumps are done. No trump. No voice of an archangel, no Jesus coming. We don't see Jesus coming in the book of Revelation until the very end for the Armageddon, for the battle of Bozrah and Armageddon. We got to go with the information that's given, not the information. We don't get to speculate on about the information that's not given and throw away about all the information that is given. You may speculate on the information that is not given, but explain the information that is given. Does that make sense? Or do I sound weird? Just explain to me. That's all. I got a list of questions that you're going to have to answer. Okay? So, and the Lord says, and of course, let's remember what the Lord Jesus said. He said, I go away to prepare a place for you. If I go away to prepare a place for you, I shall come again, receive you unto myself, that where I am, there may you be also. Okay? So the Lord's going to come. He's going to receive us so that we can be with him. And he's talking about the receiving in of the church. Now, you can take that on an individual basis, but he's talking about the church as a whole. Hello. Okay. So he says, then we which are alive and remain. This is why I say that the catching away is equal to the resurrection. Don't touch the resurrection. Be careful what you say about the resurrection. The resurrection is one of the most important. Is the crown is the crown jewel of salvation. So we which are alive and remain shall be raptured. It says right there. I say caught up, raptured. Those are two best words. Could say translated. I don't think it, I could say snatched up. So they which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with him in the clouds. So Jesus is in the clouds, about cloud level, and the angels appear and say, why do you stand here gazing up in heaven? The same Jesus should come in like manner as you've seen him go. He's going to come in the clouds. Where is that at in the book of Revelation? I tell you, this belongs to the church. This doesn't belong to the 70th week. It belongs to the church. I'm telling you, it's not in the book of Revelation because it doesn't belong in the 70th week. It's not that 70th week. The 7 years of tribulation is not about the church. It's about Israel. These things that Paul is talking about happens in the context of the things which are. Write the things which you've seen. Write the things which are. They are not about the things which shall be hereafter. The things which shall be hereafter is the 70th week. We are in a gap right now. Who would have ever thought that there would be almost 2,000 years between the 69th and the 70th week when the first 69 weeks ran contiguous with one another? Sequentially, bang, bang, bang. No, there was no gaps there. We've had a gap, and there's only one thing to put in that gap. There's only one thing that's been happening during this period of time. Hello! The church. That's it. What ends the gap? The church. And that's what Paul's saying in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. That's what he's describing when he says that the Antichrist cannot be revealed until the hinderer of sin is removed. Hallelujah. The one who stops the iniquity or the apostasy, you could say that. The anomia is more accurate, which is lawlessness. The apostates are lawless. That's why we can loosely say apostate. Are you with me? Are you following? I'm giving you my proofs of why I believe in the catching away before the tribulation. I'm not getting to all of them tonight. I really wanted today... Before tonight, I wanted to be able to publish my long list so you could just have them. I will do that, and I'll make it available so that everybody can just spend time and just go over these things and be convinced. And so to meet the Lord in the air, so shall we ever be with the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. It should be comfort, but now it's like an argument. It's not a comfort at all. I'm not going to that church anymore. I used to really have a lot of respect for that preacher, but since he preached that. Now, if I'm going to preach that you're going to get torn into pieces and smashed to little bits, then I'm suddenly anointed. But let me just get these quickly. Let me just get these last, important verses of Scripture that Paul is not the only ones. There's more. I'm not going to go into them tonight because they're a little bit more abstract. But once again, just like what he said, what I point out to you in Romans chapter 11 and verse 15, it's still concrete. If when Israel was cast away, the world was reconciled, Christ Jesus died, then when they're brought back in, what is it but the time of the resurrection from the dead? Come on now, you can't escape that. I don't know why more people don't just use that as like a banner verse of Scripture going, hello. Well, what does it mean? And that's what time period is. Where do you have your pegs in the ground set? Do you understand that Jesus talked about the abomination that makes the temple desolate because it is such an important peg in the ground to understand the events of the last day? The peg in the ground right in the middle of the 70th week of God's dealing with Israel, getting that established. If you want to understand how to really be able to grasp these things, communicate them, get that clear in your spirit and your understanding. Study out the 70th weeks of Daniel's vision until you're clear with them, until you're solid in it. Understand the abomination that makes the temple desolate. Become real clear with that in your understanding biblically, and then let that be the foundation by which then you measure everything and its distance from off of that, because now you have 2 points. Amen. Hallelujah. Got to have 2 points to navigate. Hey? Anybody know that? 1 Corinthians chapter 15. So Paul says, behold, I show you a mystery. Praise God. So it's not going to be a mystery anymore. Hallelujah. We shall not all sleep. We will not all die. We which are alive and remain will not prevent them which are dead. So we're looking at, what are we looking at? We're looking at an active, are you listening to me? An active, living, powerful church without spot, glorious, powerful, viable. That's the church he's coming for. Are you with me? We're looking at a church, a great company, not some small little insignificant small group of people in some foreign country somewhere. We're looking at the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, universal, alive, powerful, living. Gates of hell can't prevail against it. Tread upon scorpions, serpents, over all the power of the enemy, with the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ, authority over everything, without spot, without blemish, and glorious. Don't take that out of place. Show me that in the tribulation. Show me that kind of church. One place, one fragment, one little teeny bit of information on that kind of church in the tribulation. You won't find it. Its absence should be screaming at you, going, "Hold, time out, wait. Where's the glorious church?" When he's talking about we which are alive and remain will not prevent them to sleep. We're talking about a glorious church. House of spot or blemish. Church of authority. Who make disciples out of nations. Who cast out devils. Hallelujah. Who command the wind and the waves. Who can't be touched by any evil thing that Satan has done. Who are kept by the power of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, let me just grab a hold of the full impact of it. Because this then becomes a point where now you start stacking evidence to the heavens. When I begin to make the church that Jesus Christ is coming after, that will be alive when the catching away takes place, the full dimension of what Christ Jesus made the church to be, well, you know what? It just simply isn't anywhere in the 70th week revealed in Revelation chapter 6 through 18. It isn't there. Period. Doesn't exist. In fact, those saints that are identified do not have the authority of the Church of Jesus Christ that exists right now. Important point to make, subtle one. But important. We will be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. Don't see anything like that happen to anybody. It doesn't say that the 144,000 are changed. They're just caught away. The church, this is a unique event. And if it were in the tribulation, it would be highlighted. Changed in a moment, twinkling of an eye. At the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound. And the dead, the last trump before the tribulation. Because there is nothing happening in the seventh trump, but seven bowls of judgment poured out with such wrath that nobody could even imagine. Forget about it. It ain't there. If it ain't there, then what is the conclusion? It happened before these events. There is no reasonable conclusion. So, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruptible, and this mortal must put on immortality. Amen. Let's see, what else do I want to say? Well, I got a list, but okay, I'm going to leave it there. And once again, I'll publish for you a longer list, a less abbreviated one. I know I'm leaving some stuff out that I wanted to say, some arguments that I wanted to make tonight, but, you know, I also, you know, want to keep it somewhat at a reasonable amount of time. So any questions? You can ask me any question about the catching away. Okay, people that are already dead in Christ Jesus, yes. People that have died in Christ Jesus are in heaven. We have this hope, that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Okay, so they're already there. However, they do not have the resurrected body. We know if we put off this tabernacle, there is a building made of the Lord, a tabernacle made in heaven. Okay, now look at this. Just go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, just real quickly. Okay. For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, desiring to be clothed upon with our house, which is from heaven. Okay? So I can't fully describe to you what that looks like, because there is some kind of interim, as it were, tabernacle. But the resurrection of the body doesn't happen when you, in other words, you die. If you die in the Lord, which we trust is the case, amen. Then you have a place in heaven before His presence, a building not made without hand, made without hands, and your body is going to go to the earth. It will be dissolved, and you will wait for the resurrection of your body. And when your body is raised up, your body, because where's your inner man, your soul, your spirit's in heaven. Okay, it's not unclothed, it's clothed upon. Okay? Now, the earthly body is raised up, no matter whether it's nothing but dust and ashes, or even worse. I mean, if you died in the sea, right, you were digested. It shall be raised up to life again. And be joined with the inner man. So somebody said, how do you know that kind of detail? Because it's the Jesus' first fruits of the resurrection. He told us just like he's the first fruits, just like he was raised, we're going to be raised. So we see the reality of his inner man go down into hell, and he led captivity captive, and he gave gifts unto men. Okay, he did things in that state, and then on the third day, his body that was all the time laying in the tomb, that did not see corruption, unlike us, we will see corruption. He didn't see any corruption. His inner being was joined to his body, and that's the resurrection, and he was immortal, with wounds in his hands. So he forever, for all eternity, bears the marks of the crucifixion of our redemption. As a lamb slain, praise God. Amazing. Can't get overwhelmed, but when you think about that, what he's gone through for, what he went through for us. Okay? Any other questions? Yes? Yeah. 70th week is all about Israel. No, the times of the Gentiles is over. The door is closed. The door is closed. The door, just like it really, the door is closed. When you say saved, I'm talking about specifically being a part of the first resurrection. No, there is no reason to believe that. The time of God's dealing with the Gentiles is over. The whole work of the whole ministry, I'm not going to say it is impossible. Jews are saved now. I'm going to say, in general, the day and the time of God dealing with the nations. This gospel of the kingdom shall be preached to all the nations, to all the Gentiles, to all the nations. as a witness to all nations, then the end shall come. Okay? I'm saying the end has come for the Gentiles and the ministry to the Gentiles. This idea that, oh, I'm going to give my life to the Lord as soon as, boy, I'll tell you right now, as soon as that thing starts coming down, I'm going to run for the caves, and I got lima beans out there, and we'll hang out. And this is just until it's done. I mean, there's people selling generators. There's a ministry that's selling a 7-year supply of food with the ability to decontaminate your radioactive water. And for us who have a background in science, we would just chuckle at that because it's going to decontaminate it one time. You're going to get about 12 ounces of water out of that, and from there on, you're going to be glowing. Okay. Well, at any rate, but you know, no, that's not what God's saying. Father is going to do this. Here's what I believe God has shown me this, and I believe that this is provable in the Scripture. Is that the Lord is going to continue to deal with the nations until there is no more harvest. But we can rapidly see the growing hatred of mankind against God and His church. And the Lord says that we will be persecuted by all nations. Are you listening to me? We're going to see this thing come to a place of complete and total apostasy and rebellion to where the Lord says the grapes are fully ripe. In other words, sin can't get any worse than this. There's no hope for them. I mean, we can spend another 100 years with them, and we're not going to get anywhere. If we spend any more time at all with them, it's not going to result in any more harvest. The harvest is done. The harvest is over. The night has come. Now, no man can work. Hear that? The day, Jesus talking about a day. We're in the day. But there's night is coming when no man can work. Well, right now we're in the day. But when you hit the 70th week, when you hit the tribulation, when you hit that 7 years, the night has come. The door has been closed. And then when you look at the nations and every picture of the nations in the book of Revelation, just take notice of it in your next study. Just read through the book of Revelation real slow again. The response of the nations is total rebellion, and still they will not repent, and still they will not repent, and still they will not repent. And all that is doing is proving, validating that there is no more harvest. So if I real quickly look at 2 Thessalonians, which I should have done, which is one of the other verses of Scripture that Paul uses, and he uses it in reference, of course, to what he's already said in 1 Thessalonians. But he says concerning the day of Christ being at hand. Now, there were people, just like there's people today, that believe we're already in the millennial. It's not just Jehovah's Witness. There are people in Pentecostal denominations believe we're in the millennium. Man, this is a tough millennial reign. Okay, and I haven't seen any lions with lambs lately. And if you put your hand in the snake pit, you're going to get bit and you're going to swell up. And you're going to have to believe God for a miracle. So how that sensible people can believe that one is harder for me to understand than mid-trib and post-trib. I'm just going to leave that. I mean, you know, most people aren't students of the Word anyways. They don't know the Bible. They just know fragments. They know books they read. They become convinced from their teachers. But Paul says, look, I'm going to tell you concerning those people who would trouble you by word or by letter, concerning that we're living in the millennial reign of Christ, that we're living in the... Somebody said, well, Paul's talking about when Jesus is going to come. What do you mean? Paul believed he was ready. He was living continually, watching, expecting Jesus to come. He would say, yeah, this is the day for Jesus to come. He's talking about the actual reign or the millennial reign of Christ. He said, no, it's not here. In other words, that the day of Christ is here because it is a more valid way to actually translate this verse of Scripture. Okay? The kingdom of God is nigh you. You know, the kingdom of God is here. Jesus said it that way. Okay? It's in the midst of you. It's here. Okay? He says, Let no man deceive you by any means, except there come a falling away first. Now, some people have got the elliptical apodosis. There. Somebody said, what's an elliptical apodosis? It is a cheating way to get whatever word in there you want to get in there sideways. It is an explanation, a grammatical explanation for why you can say something that is not there. So I'm not going to read it. I'm leaving it out. It ain't there. I'm not going to use no elliptical apodosis. I'm going to just read it to you like this. Let no man deceive you by any means, except there come a falling away first. The man of sin cannot be revealed. So what is that? A falling away. There is an apostasy. There is an apostasy that is mounting. It's continuing to mount. He says that, and the man of sin be revealed in the son of perdition, who opposes and exalted himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he is God sitting in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Remember ye not what I told you before? Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? 1 Thessalonians. To some degree, some of it's not revealed. And now you know what is preventing that time or preventing that day. For the mystery of iniquity, which is talking about complete lawlessness or complete apostasy, is already at work. It's the Antichrist spirit bringing people in a position of hating God. It's already at work. But now there is a hinderer. And until the hinderer is removed, that wicked one cannot be revealed. Okay, so you just got to lock in right there. And what I want you to lock in right there with, and I'm just trying to read from the King James Version. What you got to lock in with right there is that there is a couple things happening. One, there is a great falling away. There is an apostasy. There is an event where there is this, this rebellion of God against God that is so intense that the only power that is preventing it from ultimately being fully, as it were, manifested and fully unleashed and taken over everything is this hinderer, this one that hinders this anomia, this iniquity. Somebody says it's government. It can't be government. There's plenty of governments. God's not going to the Lord's not going to destroy all the governments to the end of the millennial. We see the stone come down out of heaven when Christ Jesus comes at the end of the 70th week. And ultimately, we see in that context, governments are being destroyed. But he's going to rule with a rod of iron until he's destroyed the last enemy, death. Governments, as we understand them, will be destroyed at the end of the tribulation. Okay? That's the stone coming out of heaven, cut out without hands. It turns into an exceeding high mountain that fills the whole earth. Daniel's vision, right? That's Jesus coming, setting up the kingdom. Everybody with me? Does everybody track on that? Okay. So it's not governments. Okay, governments will still exist, obviously. That's what we see happening with the nations at war under the Antichrist. Somebody said it's the Holy Ghost. Not the Holy Ghost. He's still here. Holy Spirit's still here. The work of the Holy Ghost is still ongoing during the tribulation in its effect specifically with Israel. And the demonstration of the power, if nothing else, not only through the 144,000, but through the two witnesses. Are you with me? Yep. The Holy Ghost has got to do that. The only other hinderer of iniquity that is ever referred to in the Bible, and which now stands holding back iniquity on so many different levels with authority over Satan to stop Satan, to cast him out. You know, Jesus' ministry was to destroy the work of the devil. That ministry has been given unto us. Is the church. So then the conclusion is, when the church is removed, the time the Gentiles fulfilled, the anomia or the lawlessness or the apostasy now is not held back at all. It completely takes over. The disposition of men is that still they will not repent. They're literally knowing that they're going to come up against God and fight against God. There's a Luciferian worship going on. This is in the middle of the week. You've got Luciferian worship going on. Satan's actually on earth. He's cast out of heaven. He's right in the big middle of it. He wants to be worshipped. He's tattooing people as their slaves. No, Gentiles aren't being saved. It ain't about the Gentiles. I think personally, I believe that's a deception created for a false hope. I mean, you better be Christ at his appearing. You better be watching, you know, not the hour when the Son of Man shall return. Okay? Paul was really big on always being ready, looking unto the coming and hastening unto the coming of the day of the Lord. Are you with me?
Yes.
Okay. Other questions? Any other questions? Yeah. 1 John 3. Yes. It would be referring to the catching away, the resurrection. Right. So, just to make sure, I always like to just look at the verse of Scripture. For me, what is connected with that is a gifting, okay? And so I just like to go, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world does not know us, okay? Because it does not know him. Beloved, now are you the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what ye shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, or we shall see him as he is. Yeah. The resurrection. Paul, that's John, and that's a very perceptive point. Because John connected his appearing with the resurrection, just as Paul connected his appearing with the resurrection, the just. Something that is not in the tribulation, not seen in the book of Revelation, from chapters 6 through 18, thus had to happen before. And it certainly doesn't happen after. There's no place for it to happen after. Because the after is shown all the way to the chapter 22 to the eternal perfect earth. Make sense? Any other questions? Yes.
When you're talking about Revelation 4:1,
Revelation 4, meta tato, Revelation 4, the hereafter.
So,
and after these things.
Okay,
are the here and hereafter. Or after the church. And after these things. After what? After the church.
After the church. So when there was like a sound of a trumpet and he called them up, that's just a sign of the first resurrection that happened before that.
I am saying that certainly is a marvelous type and a marvelous clue that he's caught away. A door is open to heaven and he's caught away. I'm not saying that that's the actual event, but I am saying that that's your only trumpet that has a catching away in the book of in the book of Revelation, which is clearly before the tribulation really begins. Do you understand? Because the tribulation fundamentally begins at the opening of the first seal. Which is the opening of the first seal is Revelation chapter 6, verse 1. Up until that time, it's just showing you everything that's already said in heaven. Everything's, as it were, you know, the developments of what's going to now, you know, what's going on in heaven just before all this is unleashed on earth. Who knows what's written in the scroll? On front and on back. Is a scroll of cursings or a scroll of blessings? Who knows? How many of you know that? You studied it out. One person? Then I'm going to give that to you as an assignment. The scroll that no man is worthy to open, to unloose the seals, to unveil the mystery. I want you to understand, what is that? Is it a scroll of cursings or a scroll of blessing? What does the seventh seal do? The seventh seal releases the seven trumpets. What does the seventh trumpet do? Releases the seven bowl judgments. So the breaking of the seven seals finishes the wrath of God upon sin and iniquity and transgression. Right? Huh? Go back now to Daniel chapter 9. You see the completion of it in the 70th week to finish it all up, to finish up all transgression, to bring an end of all of that iniquity, the end of God's judgments, as it were. And of course, we know that there is one caveat to that that can't be fully inclusive in that statement, because it's different. It's a different category, and that's what's going to happen at the end of the 1,000-year reign of Christ, where the final separation, the final judgment against Satan and sin is levied. Amen. Any other questions? Well, good. Bless your heart, every one of you. I pray in the name of Jesus I haven't confused you. I pray that I've given you a means by which you can navigate and build off of it. If you, at the end of this, believe that the catching away happens at the end of the tribulation, I still love you. I haven't changed my opinion about you. Okay? But I would encourage you to ask me some more questions, because I got questions for you. And if you don't know how to ask me questions and you're watching by web or by YouTube right now, on our website it says email the pastor. Just go at the homepage, email the pastor, click on that soft button. That email will come directly to me, and I will answer whatever question that you send me. Amen. Love you guys. Bless you.